Tonight, we have the distinct honor of hosting Mark Clague, literally from our very own backyard. He's a part of the University of Michigan School of Music, Theater, and Dance. He is an associate professor of musicology, American culture, and African American studies, and is also the co-director of the American Music Institute. Professor Clague is an Ann Arbor native, now a nationally recognized expert on the national anthem. He is the author and producer of not just articles and books, but also a CD about the song. He is also the founding board member of the Star Spangled Music Foundation. I bet you didn't know that existed. And he is the manager of a comprehensive website, starspangledmusic.org, which has its own affiliated YouTube channel. Now, how many academics do you know, and I'm sure you know many, who can claim the distinction of their very own YouTube channel? For tonight's program, Professor Clague will explore more than 100 different sets of words to the song we know as the Star-Spangled Banner. He will trace the anthem's 200-year history from initially a broadside to a victory ballad to a protest song to anthem and back again. Tonight we'll be illustrating the program with musical examples of the many forms of the song, and I want to put you on notice that you too will be participating in tonight's performance. With Mark tonight, we have pianist Paula Sabado and soprano Jennifer Goltz will be coming to our stage. Paula is on the staff of the School of Music and has a background in teaching and performance. Jennifer is a PhD graduate of the University of Michigan with a specialty in new chamber music and cabaret, and has taught and performed widely. So we have a wide-ranging and talented crew before you tonight. Tonight's program features our new lobby exhibit. Many of you were looking at it before the program, and if not, I hope you'll look at it afterward. It's called Banner Moments, the National Anthem in American Life. It was curated by Professor Clague and comes to us thanks to his earlier display at the Graduate Library where we first saw it and met Professor Clague and said, we want to have that come to the Ford Library. So it's a fascinating exhibit, and I've already heard some wonderful comments about it. So please welcome our very own Ann Arbor folks, our colleagues and friends, Mark Clague, Paula Sabado, and Jennifer Goltz to the Ford Library.
So thanks to Elaine and to Joel for the invitation to speak to you here tonight. I'm really thrilled. I think Ford's election, when he ran for president and becoming president, was probably in some ways my first political memory. I was a kid of the bicentennial in many ways. My mom is here, and there's these pictures of me dressing up for the neighborhood parade over on Robin Hood Drive. With my little tri-corner hat and streamers red, white, and blue coming all across my Schwinn banana seat bike. And I think that's where I sort of come by my fascination with the Star-Spangled Banner. So it's really a thrill for me to be here because President Ford was a Michigan Wolverine and he had been on the same field with Bo Schembechler. He meant everything to me as a 10-year-old, long before I knew anything about anything else. So it's really an honor. Just also wanted to thank Kate Murray, who's running around, who's the coordinator of tonight's public programming, and Bettina Cousineau, who was really helpful in getting this exhibit together, which I think is just beautiful the way it has displayed in the cases here. So thanks very much to them. I also wanted to thank some of the campus entities that have helped me get this research going, the University of Michigan Humanities Institute, the University of Michigan Office for Research, the School of Music, and also the National Endowment for the Humanities, for whom I'm indebted for actually this whole year where I'm writing a book, Oh Say Can You Hear, the cultural biography of the Star-Spangled Banner. And that's really what we're talking about today is my third chapter from this book, which is all about the lyrics. Just to let you relax a little bit, we're not going to go through all 100 lyrics I've found. In part actually because I think actually it's getting closer to about 150, but I never want to promise too much and not be able to add them all up, because just even controlling all these words is pretty hard. But it takes about, 5 minutes to sing through any one of them. So if we started now, we would really have a lot of trouble getting through all 100 of them in the time we have together. But I do want to just go through some of the key ones, not to be, anyway, we'll skip that. Not to talk about the key phrases. I'll try not to do that for the rest of the day. But I did want to start with Mr. Key. So, and we're going to start right off the bat with a little bit of participation. So this is, can you hear me if I get away? I'm supposed to be mic'd up. So the first song I wanted to talk about is When the Warrior Returns. It's from 1805, and you have this in your lyric sheet. It's right behind the first thing. And our soprano, Jennifer, is actually going to join us as pianist. She's way more talented than I am, so she's going to go back and forth between keyboard and singing, maybe singing and playing. We'll see how it goes. But I wanted to go through this. This is a song that Key wrote, sort of his first patriotic song. It was written in honor of Stephen Decatur Jr. and Charles Stewart, who were the heroes of what's called the Tripolitan War. They're the first sort of big American naval heroes. And they come back to Washington, D.C. There's a young lawyer in town, just arrived a couple months before. Francis Scott Key is trying to make a name for himself. And one of the ways he does it is that there's a big party in honor of Stewart and Decatur. And he writes these lyrics, supposedly just finishing them about an hour before the party. And then reportedly, he himself sings it for the party. But I thought we could all join in. And I think you'll recognize the tune as we get going. All right, John. When the warrior returns from the battle afar to the home and the country nobly defended, oh, warm be the welcome to gladden his ear, and loud be the joy that his perils are ended. In the full tide of song, let his fame roll along to the feast flowing bore. Let us gratefully throng where mixed with the olive the laurel shall wave, and form a bright wreath for the cause of the brave. Columbians, Jennifer. So I'm really pleased that you're a great choir, because we're going to need you throughout today's presentation. I think we have two songs at the end and two songs in the middle, so just keep yourself warmed up here. The key is to breathe deeply before reaching for those high notes. And I think there is something about that. I mean, this tune requires a kind of heroic athleticism to pull it off, and I think that's intentional, right? This is about the warriors. The return, this is about the heroes. We're not going to pick a tune, you know, that's da 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 da. We're going to go dee da do dee da 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 da. All right, we want that kind of feeling. All right, so what have we learned from our sing-along? I meant to switch to this next. This is a picture of the burning of the USS Philadelphia, which is sort of what makes Stuart and Decatur famous. It's a American warship that actually had turned around, it was commissioned a little bit earlier. I think it had been involved in the quasi-war with France in the late 18th century, and then was sent to basically take on the Tripolitan pirates who were requiring a ransom for every ship that got by and was cutting into the profits. And so they instead of paying a bribe, they went and brought their own ships in. But the Philadelphia had been pursuing a Tripolitan ship and had run aground in the harbor and was captured by the enemy. And so one of our biggest gunships was in the enemy harbor. And it wasn't seaworthy so much, but it had been used to sort of defend the harbor. And Stuart and Decatur and his comrades couldn't stand the fact that an American ship and its own guns were turned on the Americans. And so they actually took over another ship, set it up so that it looked like a local Tripolitan ship. They come up at night, and they actually have a local guide who calls out in the local language and convinces them that they've been caught in a storm at sea, and they lost all of their anchors. So they couldn't drop anchors in the sea. They needed to tie up to this boat so that in the morning they could go in, because it was dark and they don't have things like radar and GPS and all those things you would need to. So apparently that was plausible because they let them tie up. And then, of course, as soon as it got dark, they jumped on the ship and tried to get it, first of all, to take it away. But since it wasn't seaworthy, they set it on fire to remove it from the enemy. And this made them hugely famous, right? So everybody, Lord Nelson, everybody said around the world said that these guys were heroes. And so when they came back, we have the song When the Warrior Returns by Mr. Key. So what do we learn about singing this song? What do you realize about the Star-Spangled Banner now that you know this tune? What's it?
It's a Johnny Come Lately.
It's a Johnny Come Lately, yeah. So the Star-Spangled Banner is written in what year? 18, it's War of 1812, but 1814, it's 2 years into it. The British had to get rid of Napoleon so that they could send the real troops to the United States. And once the real troops got here, we started to struggle a lot more. So the burning of Washington happens in August of 14, and then the Battle of Baltimore is in September of 14. So 9 years, almost 9 years after this banquet, which was in December of 1805, Francis Scott Key writes another lyric to the exact same music. Right? So what does that tell us? A couple things. He liked the music, we know that. We know that we've got his songwriting technique down, right? He takes a tune that he already knows, he writes new words. We know that this tune was, well, you may not know this, but this tune is not written by Francis Scott Key. This is a tune that's just part of popular culture, like Happy Birthday or Take Me Out to the Ball Game, or any of those tunes are for now. So it's a tune that pretty much everybody in the culture would have known. Remember, this is the 19th century. We don't have radios and MP3 players, and people are not walking around with their phones, right? So if you want music, what do you have to do? You have to sing it, just like we did, right? So people were much more comfortable singing. They had a repertoire of tunes. So this whole tradition of knowing music and making music is part of what Francis Scott Key is participating in. So 9 years later, when he's in Baltimore Harbor, and has just negotiated the release of a prisoner, he's in his own American truce ship, but he's tied up, he's under watch because he might have overheard some things during the negotiation. And basically, the British say, oh, don't worry, Frankie. We've got, this will only take a few minutes. We you know, captured Washington in about an hour. I'm sure Baltimore won't take much longer than that. So you'll be home for dinner, but you just need to wait out here until this battle's finished. And of course, the bombardment took 25 hours, and the Americans defending Fort McHenry were brave enough to never leave, and so the Star-Spangled Banner was still there the next morning when Francis Scott Key looks out, and he's inspired and writes the song. So that's sort of the history that brings it to us. But at that moment, he writes a new set of lyrics to a tune he already knew. Right? So to the tune which he used for When the Warrior Returns. This is the very first print of what we know today as the Star-Spangled Banner. It was what's called a broadside, so it's a single sheet of paper. It was put out by a local newspaper in Baltimore. Movable type, of course, had been invented, so it's very easy to put out words on paper. Rather hard to put out music on paper, right? That has to be hand engraved, takes a long time. Putting out a new set of lyrics, not a big problem. And so we have a couple of important things. One to notice is that it doesn't say the Star-Spangled Banner at the top. It says defense of Fort McHenry, because that's what he had just witnessed. And he ran off about 1,000 copies of this, and he gave them actually to the soldiers of the fort. So that's one reason why this poem ends up scattering all around the country, is because you have people from all over the country, and they're all given a copy. The other reason are newspapers and magazines and tune books. The other thing that's important is this little line right there, which you probably can't read, but we'll see a close-up of it a little later. But it says, tune Anacreon in heaven. So the tune that we just sang is known as To Anacreon in Heaven, or Anacreon. It is the club song for a musician's society in London about the time of our own revolution. So it started about 1766. It fades out of existence in the early 1790s. But somewhere around 1773, 4, 5 in there, a president, or a guy who's about to be a president, Ralph Tomlinson, writes this tune, or writes these words. And then they actually hire a local composer, the harpsichordist who played in the Anacreontic Society house band, John Stafford Smith, who was an award-winning catch and glee composer, to write this tune to animate the club song. And so the club song is sort of in the guise of the club president singing to the members. And he says, to Anacreon in heaven, where he sat in full glee, a few sons of harmony sent a petition that he their inspirer and patron would be. When this answer arrived from the jolly old Grecian, voice, fiddle, and flute, no longer be mute, I'll lend you my name and inspire you to boot. And besides, I'll instruct you like me to entwine the myrtle of Venus with Bacchus's vine. Right, so that, you saw it there, this mixed with the olive, the laurel, show wave. So the same idea of mixing myrtle and wine here at the end. So this is often called a drinking song. And I'm one of the people who falls on the side that it's not really a drinking song. It is about myrtle and Venus. And so there's some things on the internet too that they'll be, oh, this is this club of debauchery and this awful things. It's basically like Thomas Jefferson and friends play harpsichord and sing songs. And they, of course, were drinking wine, because in the 18th century you don't have water treatment plants, right? So the only thing you can drink is either has to be coffee, tea, or alcohol, the only safe thing. So it's definitely a social club. It's definitely meant for guys having a good time and singing songs. But they start out their concerts with a rollicking two-hour orchestral concert. So it's not exactly like the guys hanging out at the pub, you know, having beers. It's a very high-class, educational sort of networking club with the sort of elite of London getting together. And it's a time of real social change, when we're moving from social life really centered around the king and the court to social life settled in the middle class and happening in sort of the public sphere. And so this is one of the places of transition, because you'll have lords and not necessarily the king, but you'll have people of royalty participating in these clubs, as well as merchants and musicians. By musicians, we largely meant actors, and most of the people singing this song would have actually been sort of like Broadway singers today. They were the London stage stars, were really the ones who would have sung the song, which is part of the reason why it's so hard to sing, because it was written for a professional showing off to a bunch of other amateurs who were all trained musicians. Right? Everybody could read music. It was not meant for 100,000 people at the Big House on the weekend. Right? This is really meant for someone who was a trained singer, much more of an operatic style than sort of a folk style, right? So if you go on the internet, you'll find these people with guitars or banjos sort of twanging away, sort of claiming to be doing an original version of this. But it's really not, it's much more of a kind of opera aria. And it's meant to be funny and humorous and upbeat and fun, which is part of why, again, Francis Scott Key chooses it, because it's this aesthetic, heroic song, but it's upbeat and fun because we just beat the British. Right, so the Star Spangled Banner originally is a party tune. It's like, yeah, we beat them, we won, I can't believe it, right? I mean, when Francis Scott Key says, and God is our trust, he's like, God saved us, because he just switched sides, right? Because I was in Washington, it did not go so well, God was definitely on the side of the British, and we got here and he switched. So thank goodness. And so that's the reason that's there, but it's a song of excitement. Today, it's a sacred hymn. Right, today it's changed function, it's slowed down, because we sing it almost like we're in church, because we're singing to this flag that has been consecrated by the Civil War. So the whole tune has really changed. So when we go back to a lot of the lyrics we're talking about today, we're talking about this more upbeat thing. So this actually is a recording that I did, whoops, it was about to start, with our students here at the School of Music. But this is Jacob, who's singing the role of the club president. There's Jerry Blackstone, who's our director of choral studies. But that's a lot like what the anachronic meeting would have been like. So the star singer, probably a professional ringer, would have sung the tune to the members, and the members would have answered in harmony, because again, they're trained singers. And then this became a popular tune because the actors who were singing it for the club would then take it into the theater. If you were an actor in 18th century England, one of the ways you made money was not by through a salary. You weren't getting paid, for example, to sing at the Anachronic Society. It was too gentlemanly to pay anybody. Musicians were paid then just as they are now with free food. That's sort of how things work. But what you would do then is you had all these rich friends. And so you would have a benefit concert for yourself, right? And you would rent out a local theater, and then you would sell tickets for that, and you would get all your rich friends to buy tickets and bring their friends, and then you would sing of sort of a variety show of things. You might do a little comic sketch, you might do a little part of a play that you've been doing, and then a little bit of Anachronic Society songs, which were very interesting to everybody because, again, they're sort of fascinated with celebrities and the elite and what they were doing. So this kind of music made its way into the public sphere, and then people started writing all these different lyrics to it, because this idea of writing lyrics to well-known tunes is a very common social practice, really from the 16th through the 19th centuries, and even very recently there are some alternate lyrics I found to the Star Spangled Banner. But you would have sort of the local town crier or local singer who would have these broadside sheets. They would also be published in the newspaper. They look like poems, right? But in fact, they're not poems, they're songs. And they would have been sold for maybe a penny a piece, and the town crier would have sung them. It's often said that in a day, you know, sort of pre-literacy, that this was a way that people found out about the news. I don't really buy that. If you wanted to find out the news, there are a lot more efficient ways to get the news. You don't say, "What happened at the game last night?" Oh, well, let me tell you. At the game last night, there was quite a roar, right? And it would go on and on and on. And 15 minutes later, after 12 verses, you would find out that the score was 47-2, right? That was not the way to find out what happened. If you want to know the news, you'd say, "Who won?" "Oh, we did." "Okay, great," right? But writing lyrics to a song was a way not to understand what happened, but to understand what it meant that it happened, right? So you got the emotion of the music attached to the ideas of current events. So at a time before photography, before you could go on, get like live video feed from everywhere on the planet, if you wanted to know, you heard that there was this battle in Baltimore and that we won, but like, was it good or bad, or what does this mean? And then you hear this song and you're like, okay, good, we did well. So that's really what the ballad singer is giving you, the meaning, the emotion of the news, not just the news, okay? But there are many, 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 many of these tunes. This is Oh Say Can You Hear, which we'll hear a little bit later. This is Columbia and Independence, which is a tune sort of related to the it's sort of related to the quasi-war with France. This is actually later. This is a Civil War tune. So it's, and all of these lyrics are sung to the tune we know today as the Star Spangled Banner. Okay, every single one of them. So back to Key's broadside. This is that enlargement I promised you. Here's Oh Say Can You See by the Dawn's Early Light, and it says tune Anacreon in heaven, right? So one of the myths I'm trying to stamp out about the Star Spangled Banner that even some musicians in the 19th century would tell you because they wanted to take credit for it, they would say, "Oh yeah, Francis Scott Key wrote this poem and I figured out that this old tune Anacreon fit it and I was the one who wrote the song, The Star Spangled Banner, right? So there are a couple of musicians who got a lot of, you know, at least local celebrity for that at the time. It's not the case. Mr. Key had this tune in mind when he created this lyric. He knew it before, 9 years earlier, he had used it, right? So it was intentionally crafted lyrics to fit this melody. And so Francis Scott Key did not write a poem, even though it looks like a poem, because there's no music, it just looks like words, right? But it's not a poem, it's actually a lyric, and it's a song. This here is actually out in the exhibit. It's the University of Michigan's own copy. It's one of about a dozen that survive of the very first imprint of the sheet music of the Star Spangled Banner. And this is where the name The Star Spangled Banner comes from. This was the first time that that title happened on this song, because before it was called Defense of Fort McHenry, now it is called The Star Spangled Banner. Makes a lot of sense if you're trying to sell sheet music, right? Defense of Fort McHenry, where's that gonna sell? Baltimore. Star Spangled Banner, where's that gonna sell?
Everywhere,
right? So makes a lot of sense to change the title. So, and of course they just did the normal thing, so you take a word from the chorus and you make it the title of the song. The if any of you have an old piano sitting around at home, there's a little trick I can tell you. So this this piece of paper is the most valuable piece of commercially printed sheet music in history. The last one of them sold, actually I'll show you here, for about $500,000. And that was 6-7 years ago. So if you happen to have one of these at home, be sure to bring it back tomorrow and give it to Elaine and put it in an envelope that says Mark on it. And I'll come by and pick it up from Elaine. But if you will know, because there's a typo, under this Star Spangled Banner, it doesn't say a patriotic song, it says a periodic song, because the letter T is missing. So if you have one of those at home, as I say, you know what to do with it, so you're good. So this original sheet music we also recorded, and this was really the inspiration for my whole project, was I was teaching courses on American music, and I wanted to be able to share with my students what the original Star Spangled Banner actually sounded like, and this is what it sounded like. Choral echo that's from the Anacreontic song from the 18th century was used in the United States in the 19th century. So the original, a lot of the early lyrics for the Star Spangled Banner, the last two lines are in italics because you're supposed to sing them twice. First by the soloist and then by the community in response. So it's a pretty fantastic song because there's basically a proclamation of this idea about hope for the country that Key has, and then the community responds and agrees. Works great when you're the club president in the Anacreontic Society, too, because you say something and then everybody just echoes it right back, right? But this social ritual is actually built into 19th century versions of this song. And when we started playing it for every single baseball game, we dropped singing the second line, the last line, twice, because it makes it every performance 25% longer, right? So we cut that out. There's actually a naval regulation from, like, 1905 that says, stop doing that. Nobody can sing no repetitions in the Star Spangled Banner because it takes too long. So sort of interesting. So Francis Scott Key actually wrote about 10 songs, and they all use this exact same method of songwriting, where he wrote an established lyric to an already extant tune. He wrote six, he was a very religious guy, so six of them, his 10 songs are hymns. Two are popular sacred songs, and two are these patriotic songs that you both now know. or the both of them, you know, be, When the Warrior Returns and the Star-Spangled Banner. But I thought it'd be fun to sort of get a sense of Key's other music by having Paola and Jennifer join us to sing a verse that he added to a famous song by Robert Burns, the Scottish poet, called, the song is called John Anderson, My Joe, but Key ends up adding a third verse to this song, and it very much speaks to Key's own deep religiosity. He was a student at St. John's College in Annapolis, and basically a deist came to, a student came in who was basically what we today we probably call more of an atheist, right? Who was very dubious about the Bible. And Francis Scott Key and his buddies were not really sure what to make of this, didn't really know. They had, Francis Scott Key's mother in particular was very religious, and one of Francis Scott Key's best friends sort of took on this visiting student publicly and said, no, you're wrong, you know, you should not doubt religion. And this was sort of a moment of conversion for Francis Scott Key, who then became a lay minister in the Protestant Episcopalian Church. And so very, very religious from that point on in his life. And so John Anderson, My Joe is basically the story of an old couple looking back on their lives. It uses a metaphor of a hill. So as when they're young, they climb up the mountain sprightly. As they age, they climb down the mountain. And they get to the bottom of the, that's for Robert Burns, that's the song. And what Francis Scott Key says is, just your lifetime, that's not the whole story. There's an afterlifetime. And so we need a third verse to really represent the entire life of a human soul. Fantastic. So this melody was hugely popular, the melody of the Star-Spangled Banner, was hugely popular in the United States. And a scholar working for the Library of Congress named Richard S. Hill and did most of the work on this, although he based it on another Librarian of Congress, Oscar Sonic. And so the Librarians of Congress, and particularly in the music division, have been sort of the experts on the Star-Spangled Banner throughout history, because they're the ones who get the letters from the school teachers that say, where did this tune come from and what does it mean? They send it to the representative, and the representative forwards it over to the Library of Congress and says, tell me what to say. And so they've done a lot of the research on this. So I've built my work on theirs. And adding my work to Mr. Hill's, I've come up with about 80 sets of lyrics to the tune we know as the Star-Spangled Banner that predate the Star-Spangled Banner. Right, so one of those, of course, is When the Warrior Returns. But 79 other ones are other tunes by other people on different topics entirely. A lot of, about 67 or so, are American patriotic tunes. So the important thing is that Francis Scott Key did not make up the idea of taking this tune and writing patriotic lyrics to it. He's actually part of a tradition. So I'll tell you a little bit about that tradition. It starts with sort of basically songs about the French Revolution. George Washington, of course, is president in the 1790s, and he ends up retiring after two terms, so we got to celebrate that. He's got a birthday every year. We used to celebrate that then. There's the 4th of July. We actually started celebrating that in 1777. So we need songs for that. So we write new lyrics to this same tune. And we got campaign songs for Thomas Jefferson written to this tune. And so all of these different songs are all in sort of the mind's ear of Francis Scott Key when he's in Baltimore Harbor, right? So he's writing a tune. So the very first one is from about 1790. It was written by Francis Hopkinson, who's one of the signers of the Declaration of Independence. It's actually just on a scraggly piece of paper. And it's actually interesting how this particular lyric was authenticated, because it's written in a different hand than Francis Hopkinson's own hand. Hopkinson was sort of the very first composers. He was a student at University of Pennsylvania, wrote a set of songs, art songs. But in the 1790s, early in 1790, he had a stroke. And so he lost the ability to write. And so the people around him would write for him, and then he would just sign it at the end. And so there's this very squiggly signature that's his characteristic signature, except it looks like it's, you know, it's like I'm writing with my left hand, right? It doesn't look really like me, but it has all the same marks in it. So they basically determined, when they found this piece of paper in the Library of Congress, they said, this has got to be the real thing, because nobody would know enough about Hopkinson's medical history to know that at this very moment, he would have actually had someone else write it, and he would have had this scrawly signature. So there's this particular thing. But it's a parody of the Anacreontic song. It's much more in the vein of the original. It's got gods running around Mount Olympus. It's more of a drinking song, comic song kind of thing. But very quickly after that, in 1793, we start getting these songs for the French Revolution. And they're basically on both sides, the Francophile side and the Anglophile side. Of course, the French Revolution, France, and Mr. Lafayette were very helpful for our revolution. So a lot of people, particularly those around a guy named Thomas Jefferson, were very helpful and very much in support of the French. A lot of other people were, particularly in the New England area, were very attached to Britain and trade. And of course, whenever France or Britain went to war, the other one had to go on the other side, right? Just part of the reason why French jumped in with us. But anyway, the very first sort of publicly published lyric. So the Francis Hopkinson one I talked about before wasn't published until the 1950s. Okay, that was just in a piece of paper in Francis Hopkinson's papers. Nobody knew about it. The very first one to be publicly available was for the commemoration of the glorious 14th of May, which is the French Revolution, that was published in 1793. Freedom Triumphant is another tune, again, all to the Star-Spangled Banner. And then this is an interesting one. A couple years later, for the 4th of July, 1795, was actually written by a French diplomat in Paris for a dinner hosted by the future President James Monroe, who was the diplomat to France in 1795. And all these are sort of the pro-French ones. And then there's this one, Tous Genêts in New York, which is about Charles Amon Genêts, who was the French ambassador who came and tried to raise an army of Americans to go back and fight, was giving out basically legal papers to privateers to take over French ships. And Mr. Washington didn't exactly like another guy raising an army in his own country, so that didn't go over very well. So there's one of these parody signs as an anti-French Revolution song, but again, written to the exact same tune. So one of the important things about this, the fact that there are pro and anti-France songs, not only sung in the United States, but sung in Paris, right? All to the same melody, is part of the evidence I use to say this is really not, this is no longer an English tune. Right? Nobody in this, in the United States at this time is thinking, oh, Anacreon, yeah, that's that old British tune. They're thinking, oh, that's that tune I heard last week down at the pub, or I heard at the theater, right? It's an American tune. It doesn't have any association with Europe at this point or with France or England, because there would be nothing more insulting for the ambassador to France to do than to sing a pro-French song to a British tune in Paris, right? That would not make you any friends, right? So what that means to me is not that James Monroe had a really sick sense of humor. What it means is that this tune was not associated with Europe, with Britain more than France or the United States. It was just part of the cultural mix of sort of the sonic scape of that era, okay? So the next tune, that really it becomes the big famous Anacreontic parody prior to the Star-Spangled Banner, is this tune, Adams and Liberty. It's from 1798. And it's about John Adams, President Adams. It also refers to George Washington. But it's really about his supporting him at a very troubled time in the nation's history. During the quasi-war with France, we sort of freaked out about foreigners. I don't know if you've ever heard of this happening, but it's when the Alien and Sedition Acts were passed. We suspended the writ of habeas corpus because we were really worried that everybody was out to get us. And John Adams was the first one-term president, in part because of this controversy. And the tune Adams and Liberty was written in support of Adams by Robert Treat Paine, but it was supported from Boston, okay? But this tune took off. This became published in sheet music. It was in 5 editions within 2 years. It was published in newspapers. But I think particularly because it was published in sheet music was really important, because that melody, before, there was only one of these French Revolution songs, the Free and Triumphant, that actually has the melody, whereas 5 of these do. And so musicians all around the country now started to get this notation, and they could sit down at the piano and they could play it. And there's all sorts of occasions during the early 2 decades of our country where we would have these patriotic dinners. So every year there would be a Washington's birthday celebration, and you'd get together and each town would have its own dinner party, and you would do a series of toasts, and you would usually toast, you know, to President Adams, and then they would sing this song, right? So that's one way that everybody got to know it. But musicians could do it because they had the music. So those sheet music publications are really important. So Adams and Liberty is sort of the big first hit of the Anacreontic songs. The previous ones were all in newspapers. A few people might have known them. But this is the one that everybody knew, including probably a guy named Francis Scott Key. This is likely where he heard it first, because Francis Scott Key's uncle, Barton Key, was his legal sort of inspiration anyway, not necessarily his teacher, but was a Federalist Party member. And so the Federalist Party was where John Adams came from, right? So this would have been seen as a Federalist Party song at the time. So this is from a newspaper talking just a year after Adams and Liberty is written. And he's talking about the importance of these poets and the role they play in helping to shape the democracy, right? So the poets of our country are patriots. In rousing the American people to a sense of their danger, they have been in the advance guard. That they are not wearied in well-doing, almost every public celebration gives abundant evidence. In the ranks of this tradition, Adams and Liberty should be the commander. So this was the big hit political song. And this particular editor, who's writing actually in a party or a paper from Washington, D.C., is sort of saying these songs are an important aspect of our democracy, of telling people what's going on and what they should be doing and rousing them to action, okay? So this is the conversation, the musical conversation that Francis Scott Key joins. He doesn't start it, he joins it. And it's particularly an American conversation because the tune, so there were composers later on that a guy named James Hewitt in particular who wrote what's actually a version of the Star-Spangled Banner I really like. But it's Key's word, but a totally new, different melody, a melody you don't know. And the reason he did that is because it offended him so deeply that anybody could write a American patriotic song to a British tune. That really annoyed him. Now, of course, where did James Hewitt do his musical education? London, right? So he was English. So for him, this tune was English. So he immigrated here. He was like, why are they all singing this tune that I know from back home? This is crazy, right? And the reason they were doing it is because for Francis Scott Key, this wasn't a British tune. This was an American tune because he heard it all the time in America. It had nothing to do with Britain, right? He doesn't write it to a British tune. He writes it to what, to him and to everybody else, is just an American tune. He's commenting and joining a conversation about current events, about American ideals, about freedom, about liberty, about the land of the free, the home of the brave, right? He's offering his vision for society. So what's interesting to me, so I told you there are about 80 lyrics or so that I found that predate Key. How many did I say I found total? About 150 or so. So this thing continues. So Key is not the end of the conversation either. He propels it to a whole new level because his song becomes really important in its own right. It's the next great hit of the Anacreontic parodies, right? So first it's Adam Liberties, then it's the Star Spangled Banner. It's the one everybody's singing that one now. We put it out in sheet music and we sell it all around the country. We put it in magazines, a lot of which are out in the exhibit. The very first case that's just outside the door is the one that has all the early sheet music, okay? So other people pick up on this. And it's even more powerful now than it was when we had Adams and Liberty, because now we have the image of the flag, right? Its association with American ideals has been deepened. So we can comment not just on Adams and Liberty or the current political crisis, but we can start to comment literally on the fabric of the nation, right? We're saying, what holds us together? What are those stars and stripes? What do they mean, right? What's the red, the white, and the blue? What are these symbols? And one of the things we celebrate, of course, in the Star Spangled Banner is that big high note, right? Oh, the land of the free, right? So freedom is a huge part of this tune. In 1814, who does freedom apply to? Everybody? No. And so abolitionists notice this irony, right? So this is one of the next really powerful songs. So Land of the Free, this is the back cover of the American Anti-Slavery Almanac from 1843, which has the Star Spangled Banner, a Liberty pole with a Liberty cap, which were very important symbols in the War of 1812, and then the Star Spangled Banner, and an African slave literally bound by the same cord with his hands and feet that holds up the flag. Right? So this idea that we are free strikes people like William Lloyd Garrison or a man from Michigan, E.A. Attlee, who was a reveillant in Battle Creek, who was called a station master on the Underground Railroad. He was helping escaped slaves get away from the South, come to Michigan, get through Detroit into Canada, into freedom. And he writes a parody in July of 1844 to the Star Spangled Banner. He calls it a new version of the national song. Right? It's not the national anthem yet. That didn't happen until 1931. But this is a national song at this point, and it's picked up by Garrison's The Liberator, and it uses the banner melody and this irony between what freedom means to Francis Scott Key and what freedom means to an African American in a productive way to call into question what it means. And this is probably the most powerful, sort of emotionally visceral lyric that I've found. It ends with this notion of that the Star Spangled Banner is at half mast, because we are not the land of the free, we're the land of the slave.
Thank you.
So now we come back to the participatory aspects of the evening's entertainment. The Civil War is an incredibly important time for the Star-Spangled Banner, in part because there's kind of symbiosis between song and flag, and the fact that the flag ends up representing the Union, and that Abraham Lincoln refuses to take any stars off the flag. There's 34 at the beginning of the war, and then 13 states secede, and he leaves all 34 right where they were. He says, nope, you can't go away. We're keeping the flag just as it was. And so even though at the very beginning of the war, actually both North and South claim the Star-Spangled Banner as their song, it ends up, because the flag stays with one side, it ends up being the song of the North, not the song of the South. And the South goes through a bunch of different songs. And they sing the Marseillaise, among other things, because all true rebels and revolutionaries sing the Marseillaise. But this actually predates the Civil War by just a few months, right? So this is a campaign song written for a candidate named Abraham Lincoln, who is running for president. And it is sung, as you would imagine, from the topics of today's talk, to the tune of the Star-Spangled Banner. So Paula, if you want to come back up, do you want to lead this one for us?
Yeah, sure.
All right, you have a way better voice than I do, so we're definitely going to go with you. So you have the lyrics in your program, if you can join Jennifer. Stay there. I think we have your solo coming up. Oh, I just had the... Yeah, so here... So in the Civil War, basically this symbiosis between song and flag deepens the relationship of the country to the Star-Spangled Banner. So really, there's another tune called Hail Columbia, which especially in the early... It was written for George Washington. It was originally an inauguration march, and then it gets a set of lyrics when he steps down from the presidency. And that is sort of the go-to anthem kind of thing for the United States up until the Civil War, and the way in which, as I said, the flag itself is sort of sanctified through the sacrifice of all of the many men and women who participated in that war on both sides. And so the flag becomes sacred, the song starts to become increasingly sacred. And there's this growing patriotic fervor and pride. And so one of the things that leads to is the arranging of this tune for the home music market, because at this time there's also an explosion in piano manufacturing, and basically every good home in the United States has to have a piano. And so we have to have sheet music for those. And so we have this Star Spangled Banner with brilliant variations, which is when you have your young daughter taking piano lessons and she proves to be very good, you put her down with this and have her show off. Available for your next 4th of July barbecue if you need a pianist. Be sure to Let me know. I'll put you in touch with her. So after the Civil War, one of the interesting things that happens is that in the South, and this is actually from a different chapter in my book, there's all these parody lyrics making fun of the Yankees written to the Star-Spangled Banner. Because the song was no longer sacred for the South, because that was the enemy's tune, right? But in the North, you didn't mess with the Star-Spangled Banner. If you needed to add something to Key's story, which of course you did, because you had these people in the Confederacy, you had to make fun of them, or at least you had to talk about the terrible tragedy of them trying to leave the Union, you added another verse. And so actually, if you go outside, you'll notice there's John Philip Sousa's arrangement of the Star-Spangled Banner, which is from 1889, which he wrote for the Navy when he was there. Because, of course, the one place that really needs to know everybody's anthem in the world is the Navy, because they keep showing up with boats in different ports, and they meet the local governor, and they got to play the right song, right? So John Philip Sousa, the first thing that actually made him famous was this book. And so he puts his arrangement of the Star-Spangled Banner, and there's five verses, because it has an extra fifth verse by Oliver Wendell Holmes. But in 1889, we have something called the National Peace Jubilee, because we have this rather big division in the country. We're trying to heal that wound. And so we have this huge mega concert with like 1,000 musicians and 12,000 singers. And among the things we do is we sing the Star-Spangled Banner. And in order to resolve the tension in this song, which is really a song born of war, we now make it a song of peace by adding a fifth verse about peace. So this is another sing-along. If you'll find it on the third page of your handout. Of at least voting were women in the 19th century, right? So the very first state to allow women to vote was actually Wyoming in 1869. And then a bunch of states sort of very late in the century in the 1890s, Colorado, Idaho, and Utah. But this idea of women voting was also a cause for writing these kinds of songs. And there were entire books published of hundreds of song lyrics sung to Yankee Doodle and the Battle Hymn of the Republic, and America the Beautiful is existing in the early 20th century. And one of them, this is one of the more recent discoveries I found, because I didn't think there were initially any Star-Spangled Banner parodies, because when you look at these sort of World War I era, so the 19th Amendment wasn't passed until 1920, and World War I is sort of a key moment in Star-Spangled Banner history, because that's when President Wilson proclaims the Star-Spangled Banner to be the national anthem of the U.S. military. And so I had sort of come to the conclusion that there were no equal rights or suffrage Star-Spangled Banner lyrics because of the fact that in World War I it had become this sacred song. And it's a little bit insulting, right, to start changing the words on this. In the 20th century, the politics of expressing new identities in the Star-Spangled Banner really is one of musical style, right? So you have Jimi Hendrix or Jose Feliciano or Beyonce or Diana Ross or Whitney Houston singing at the Super Bowl, and they sing it in a way that says, I'm here, and the music that's of my church, the gospel tradition, for example, with Whitney Houston, right, is part of what's in this world of the Star-Spangled Banner, too. But it's a kind of politics of musical style. In the 19th century, it's the politics of words. As you're noticing, we've changed the musical arrangements. We're using ones from different parts of history. And you're probably, as we're singing along, you're jumping too early, or you're moving a little bit differently. It's because the Star-Spangled Banner actually melodically is something that's really more of a folk song than a composition. And so there's all this variation in the rhythm, in the notes. You probably notice that a lot of them don't start, oh, say, they start, oh, say, can you see? Because that triadic descent was not something that was even that common until the 20th century. So there's a lot of musical, anarchy would be too strong a word, but let's say just sort of democratic exuberance in the way we sang the Star-Spangled Banner. But I thought, well, maybe there are no women's suffrage Star-Spangled Banners, because by World War I, it wouldn't, if you're trying to claim that you are going to be responsible and you deserve the vote, you maybe don't want to mess with the national anthem. However, turns out that at Seneca Falls, we, in 1884, we weren't there yet. And so there is, in fact, a women's suffrage equal rights banner written by a reverend from Indiana, Reverend C.C. Hera. So another interesting phenomenon which I've come across in, Star-Spangled Banner history is how often we actually translate it into other languages. This starts actually in New Braunfels, Texas, with a version of the Star-Spangled Banner in German that then gets picked up by the Union during the Civil War to recruit former Hessian troops that had been brought over to fight during the Revolution. So their descendants were still speaking German, and the Star-Spangled Banner in German was one of the things that convinced them to join the Union cause. We sometimes did this, I think, for sort of academic exercises. So there's a Latin translation called Vexillum Stellatum from 1918. There are also a lot of communities, sort of regional churches in all sorts of different languages, Czech, Swedish in this case, Norwegian, that would translate, have a hymn, and a lot of times Hymns will have a section of national feast days in the back, and so they would put that in the local language of the church, and so the new immigrants coming to the community would again get to learn a little bit about the country around the 4th of July. There's a translation in French that was actually dates from World War I, and it's sort of interesting because it's translated in France and then sold back to the United States, and the translation's pretty loose. It's like, the manly, strong, fabulous United States, please come save us, is basically what it says. The thing about Star-Spangled Banner sort of leaves that alone. But then there's this translation that's pictured is actually sort of an official U.S. government translation from 1919 of the Star-Spangled Banner into Spanish, which was meant to sort of unite the Americas, right? So I don't know if you remember, in 2006, there was a version of the Star-Spangled Banner that came out done by a bunch of Latin pop stars, and it was very controversial at the time. It was actually this translation. Everybody's like, I can't believe it, they're singing in Spanish, this is crazy. Well, actually, they took this government publication from almost 100 years ago, and they sang that. And that's what got everybody all upset. So context is everything when it comes to understanding the Star-Spangled Banner. A lot of times, what's happening in the world is how people hear it. And so it's sort of interesting because people will say, well, they want a traditional version of the Star-Spangled Banner. But what tradition means, as you're starting to see, is very squirrely. There's no one way to sing it. And we don't sing it today like Francis Scott Key did, right? So all bets are off on how you're supposed to sing this thing. And what tradition means to us is we really want the one we remember as representing us. You know, I think that comes closest to our hearts that we remember from when we were kids. And believe it or not, the most frequently translated language of the Star-Spangled Banner, I have six separate translations, is Yiddish. And a lot of these came up in the 1930s and 40s, which cannot be an accident, cannot be coincidental, right? It's a group of people, as Kristallnacht is happening, as Germany is falling apart and the Holocaust is starting, saying, hey, we're here, and we're loyal Americans. We've actually been here for a long time. We came over because of the pogroms in the 1890s, and we have friends and relatives, and we need to help them. So, you know, the greatest number of single translations is Yiddish. The next one is Spanish. But our fabulous opera singer here, who can sing in any language, actually, I think you have a neighbor who's Swedish, right?
I do. I haven't done the Swedish version without him.
All right, let's hear it.
Schwer noch aus Lüste, ich war noch
So I'm writing this book on the history of the Star Spangled Banner. I got other chapters to fill out, but I just, what questions have come to you so far? What else do I need to say? Yes. Can you actually use the microphone? I think we're taping this. If other people have questions, if you just want to line up behind her, that could be a way to handle it.
Well, then I have two. First of all, it's just a fast local history. Uh-huh. I'm wondering if you're related to Ashley Clague, who we have a middle school named after.
That was my grandfather.
Okay, well, hooray. Okay, there's one thing. And the second, if you found Yiddish translations and Swedish, I wonder if you found any Japanese translations for the people who were put in the internment camps who so willingly gave their sons to prove their loyalty?
That's a great question. I've looked for them. So I've looked through, there are one of the incredible things that's helped my research, and if any of you want to get fascinated with Star Spangled Banner parody lyrics or any of these, there are all these newspaper databases online. The Library of Congress has one now. It's under the website Chronicling America. But you can search an enormous number of newspapers. And actually, some of the newspapers you can search are the newspapers that the Japanese internment camps published internally. And there are actually, the Star Spangled Banner is lyric, and references to it are fairly frequent in those newspapers, but they're always in the original language. And I think that was sort of part of the point, as they were trying to prove that they were assimilated and that they were loyal, and that using sort of the politics of language to say we're singing this in the original was strategic at that moment. I have, however, found it in like American Samoan. So you may know that the largest percentage of military veterans in any area of the United States is actually in America, Samoa. It's like 45% of the population are veterans. So there is a translation, Hawaiian, Americans, a lot of Native American languages, Cherokee and Navajo, but not in Japanese, at least as of yet.
Firstly, a little comment. I thought it was ironic that there was so much concern in Monroe's time about using a melody of British origin. I am old enough to remember when we sang a song called My Country Tis of Thee, which seems to have had British origin as well.
Yeah. God save our glorious king. Yes, exactly.
Two questions mostly based on the display. Mm-hmm. One is, which I've seen many times, the flag at the National Museum of American History at the Smithsonian. Is that the big one that wasn't flown that day, or the smaller one that was?
So the one that survives and that's in the was kept in the Armistead family. So the general who was guarding or in charge of the Fort McHenry during the battle is the large garrison flag. So it was the flag that was flown the next morning. It was 30 feet by 40 feet. It was meant to be enormous and basically, again, you know, we're at a time when you would have been looking through a telescope. It was meant to be sort of a defiant, you know, wave to the British as they came down the Chesapeake towards the fort. So it was intentionally a very large flag. And that flag is the one that's in the Smithsonian Museum of American History.
And that's what Key saw.
And that's the one that Key saw. You bring up a good point, which is it's probably not the flag that was there during the battle. During the battle, there was a huge rainstorm. And if you've been to Fort McHenry, you know that the flagpole is made out of wood, right? As most flagpoles were in 1814. To put a giant cotton flag that was 30 feet by 40 feet on a pole during a rainstorm would have literally torn the flagpole down. And so they ran up a much smaller battle flag that was there. So you'll sometimes see, like, there's a hole, there's a star missing in the Star Spangled Banner. So often you'll read online, because of course everything online is completely correct. You'll read about the cannonball that went flying through the flag and took out that star, right? What really happened is that the Armistead family had this big, huge flag in their sort of personal collection for about 100 years, and they would cut off little pieces of it to give to people as souvenirs. And so the flag now is almost square. It's 30 by 30, basically, because about 10 feet was cut off the end to give in to various people. So you will every once in a while find little pieces of flag that are probably not in an antique shop, because they tend to go in auction. But the little pieces are actually in better condition most of the time than the real flag, because they've been kept in a drawer dry the whole time. So, but the flag itself is fabulous, and the exhibit, the way they have it done in the Smithsonian. When I went there as a kid, it was probably like when you saw it, where it was hanging, you know, you walked in and there it was. Now it's laying down flat in this very dark room, but it's sort of a beautiful cinematic journey to walk around that. And you'll actually hear all sorts of different versions of the Star Spangled Banner as you walk through, so it's pretty fantastic.
Real quickly, is there any truth to the story that we adopted a national anthem in 1931 because an American team was going to the Olympics and every other country had a national anthem to play and we didn't?
No. So it was adopted March 3rd, 1931, the little birthday just passed. President Hoover actually signed the Congressional Act that made it the Star-Spangled Banner. The entire act is one sentence long. It says the song known as the Star-Spangled Banner is the national anthem of the United States. That's the whole thing. It does not have an official lyric. It does not have an official piece of music. It just says that song. But it had been the earliest. I just wrote this chapter on sports. So the medal ceremony as we know it today doesn't start until the 1924 Olympics. But the Star-Spangled Banner had been used as the national anthem in the Olympics. It's really right after World War I that they start doing that ceremony. Prior to that, you didn't do a lot of national anthems at the Olympics because it wasn't about the nations, it was about the brotherhood, right? I think once the League of Nations was founded, there was sort of this idea that you had these strong nations and that they would all cooperate. And so the sonic language of the Olympics actually changes in the early 1920s.
Yeah, after hearing the Charles Grobe's Star-Spangled Banner with brilliant variations, I realized that Jimi Hendrix's performance at Woodstock was just in a 115-year-old tradition.
Very good. I like
variations.
That.
I have a question. That is, I remember reading a few years ago that there used to be laws saying if you played the Star-Spangled Banner, you had to play the whole thing. You couldn't cut it short or do any variations on it. Was this the case, at least in some states?
So it was actually, and there was actually a law in the state of Michigan to this effect. So what happens is in the early 19-teens and 20s, before you get to the 1931 bill from the U.S. Congress, the state of Maryland, which was a big advocate for the Star-Spangled Banner because Fort McHenry is in Baltimore, their congressman, Charles Linthicum, was one of the people who was really pushing this bill through Congress. And so one of the things that he did is he got his buddies in state legislatures from around the countries to pass their own laws making the Star-Spangled Banner at least more important in some way. And so a lot of these bills were written sort of imitation of this bill from Maryland. And so there are these little state bills. Michigan was one. There's one in Massachusetts. There's one in Maryland. So there's about five of them in the country. And they're never enforced. And actually, Michigan's was just repealed about 2 years ago because it was in a batch of bills that were sort of seen to be, one was about carrying ice cream in your back pocket. I mean, there was all sorts of crazy stuff, and they basically said, we don't do it. But one of the things they were concerned about was actually using the anthem in a medley, right, where you would bring it in and use like Yankee Doodle and put other things with it. And that was one of the things that bothered them, was they considered improper. So a lot of the stuff about playing it complete and means to just play just the Star-Spangled Banner, don't combine it with any other songs, and just treat it as a special thing. And that was, but it was always in state law, it was never in federal law. There's no federal law that governs anything about the Star-Spangled Banner, except that it's the anthem.
Thank you.
In this day of personal protest, I'm interested in the tradition of standing for the anthem and when that began.
So that's a good question. So there's no law about when you're supposed to stand or whether you're supposed to put your hand over your heart or how you're supposed to behave. There are, it sort of starts as a tradition right around the turn of the century, so it predates World War I. And so there's one of the things I found, I just finished the chapter on sports about a month ago, and one of the things, there's this report of an Army-Navy game from 1899. And it goes like wildfire, this report that's reprinted in almost every newspaper I can find in the United States. And basically what happens is that the Navy band shows up and the teams are warming up and they're just playing music and they play the Star-Spangled Banner. And all of the players on the field stop what they're doing, turn to the flag and put their hands, you know, salute, I guess, because they're trained in the military. And the crowd freezes and turns to the flag too. And so this author who wrote this newspaper account that gets picked up, it sort of goes viral, if you will. It gets tweeted out and then everybody retweets it. But it happens in print in the newspaper. It's a weird kind of time. They did this kind of stuff. But anyway, said this is amazing and this is what Americans should do. They should show their respect to the flag. And so you'll see accounts like that all the time. And usually it's in the negative. Like, I was at this thing, this game, or at this event, or at the civic ceremony, and they played the Star Spangled Banner, and people weren't behaving in a way with reverence, and then it would be criticized. And so you see that kind of critique actually all the way up really through the Second World War. So it's something that sort of grows gradually, but it comes out of military practice into civilian practice is where it comes from. The really amazing thing it's also trained into school children. So, and that really starts in the 1890s. So 1892, which was the 400th celebration of Columbus's discovery of America, is a time when, again, this healing from the Civil War, somehow singing that peace lyric in 1869 didn't fix all the problems. But one of the ways in which patriotism was brought, or sort of the unity between North and South was instilled, was actually through kids, because they weren't alive during the Civil War. And so there was a lot of movement in public schools to bring patriotism into schools. And so one of the things that was written was the Pledge of Allegiance, which is from the 1890. And it was written by a guy named Francis Bellamy, who had a salute that was used, which looks like that. And that became very different in World War II, and so that becomes this. But there are these amazing pictures from like right around the turn of the century of entire groups of school kids facing a Star Spangled Banner with something that looks like it's out of Nazi Germany in the way they're representing to the flag. So, but it's called the Bellamy salute. Yeah.
In the song "The Banner of Freedom,"
yeah.
Abe Lincoln's name is mentioned, and it's saying the honest, the noble, and true. And then the next line, "And with him in our Hamlin."
Yep.
Who are they referring to? I have relatives whose last name is Hamlin, and that's the first time.
So Hamlin was Lincoln's vice president.
Ah, boy. Yep. I don't know
about first vice president, right. The first time he was elected. So that was 1860, yeah. Do you know his first name?
Hannibal.
Okay, Hannibal Hamlin. That's great. How could you forget that? Oh, I had it on there? Okay, good. I thought you guys are amazing. Really impressed. I should turn around every once in a while and look at my own slides. Good question, yeah.
Can another stanza ever be added, and if so, how could you do it?
I think the amazing thing is, and I sort of, you know, my starspangledmusic.org website is meant really for K-12 teachers, and one of the things I hope that's done is to really revitalize the wonder that is American history by understanding all of the complexity and all of the debates we had about who we are and who we should be and who was free and who wasn't free and who had the right to vote and didn't right to vote. And you know, that really comes across in our anthem. Part of the way we see it now, I think we take the anthem sort of for granted. I mean, to me, it's like the salt and pepper shaker on the table. You know it's there, but you can never find it because, you know, I mean, you don't ever question it. You don't ask about it. You don't ask what it means. You don't ask where it came from. Or, you know, what we know about the anthem in Francis Scott Key is largely what we know about the first verse, right? Oh, the flag, it was there, it was the morning, he looked up, like, yeah, that was the whole story. But it's basically what it tells you and you sing it, right? We don't really know necessarily much more than that. And so recapturing that story, I think, tells us a lot. So what would be interesting is to have kids these days write new lyrics, maybe not to the Star Spangled Banner, maybe to a different tune, I don't know, but to write their school anthem or something like that. I've been visiting schools where every student has created their own flag, what symbols the kids would put on it, or where the class wrote with their music teacher a new song, a song for the school or a song for the community. But I think that would, you know, for me, Francis Scott Key is a pretty inspiring figure in what he does, because he's an individual guy working in Washington, D.C. He's a lawyer, he's pretty well connected, but he creates an act of citizenship. I mean, he writes a poem, a lyric, about a moment that he thinks is really important, and it ends up past all reason and you know, understanding, surviving for 200 years. And we sing it all the time, right? So those kinds of little acts of citizenship, I think, are one of the things that I hope people will continue to do in whatever way they think works for them. But writing songs would be a great way to be an American, I think. Last one.
You mentioned that the Star Spangled Banner was made the national anthem in 1931. Why did they choose that instead, as opposed to many of the other patriotic tunes like America the Beautiful or My Country 'Tis of Thee and so forth?
That's great. Good question. So there were all sorts of people who came out against the Star Spangled Banner as a national anthem. Music teachers were one of them, right? It's too hard to sing. Pacifists were not high on the Star Spangled Banner. It's a war song. Some nationalists were not, because it was understood at this time that it's an English tune. Prohibition was, you know, the thing in the 1920s, right? So a song that was affiliated with this club, social club in London that met at the Crown and Anchor Tavern, not a good thing. The words were sort of antiquated. So there were lots of reasons not to pick it. There were other choices, obviously. Yankee Doodle, America the Beautiful would have been one. So God Bless America was not considered because nobody knew about it yet. Kate Smith started singing it in 1938. Right, so it had been written by Irving Berlin in 1918, but it wasn't popularized yet. But I guess the ultimate reason is that nobody really chose it. So one of the things that's happened actually as early as 1812 is the first time I saw a newspaper competition to write a national anthem. They're like, we need one, somebody write one. You can't on purpose write an anthem or pick it. It's picked by sort of collective action of a community. The song that they sing that they find most meaningful to them is the national anthem. So in my mind, the Star Spangled Banner becomes the national anthem between 1861 and 1918, right? Between the Civil War and the First World War. That's sort of because of the repetition and the way people treated it and the way they felt about it. And those two wars sort of make it the national anthem. Congress doesn't get around to recognizing that fact for 17 years. They're a little slow. Who knew? Right? But it wasn't really Congress that picked it. It was already being called the national anthem as early as 1844, right? The national song or things like that. People were treating it as such, you know, literally almost 100 years before, because it really has to do more with what people do with the music than it is who gives it the official title. So I think it is the official national anthem, but it was chosen by people. So that's another reason why I think it's going to be really hard to change. Every once in a while people say, well, it really should be America the Beautiful, because it's a much more pretty song. I'd rather hear that, and it's easier to sing, and you know, it's about seas and redwoods and forests and all this good stuff. That's a much better song. It's gorgeous. However, I do think there's a social function to the Star Spangled Banner, which is that, you know, obviously a very important thing in all of our lives was 9/11, right? And so when 9/11 happened, what happened musically? Do you remember? Everyone was singing the Star Spangled Banner, but everyone was singing something else even more. God Bless America, right? So those two songs, we had concerts at the School of Music that we held at our auditorium. So God Bless America becomes hugely important. So the minute that we sort of figure out what had happened and we go to war in Afghanistan, what happens? We switch to the Star Spangled Banner, right? Because there's an aspect of that athleticism, of that heroism that Francis Scott Key recognized in this melody that convinced all of those people in the 1790s to pick this song to talk about American patriotism, right? And these are people who lived through the Revolution. Right, are the ones who started this tradition that Francis Scott Key gloms onto, right? This melody has something about it that galvanizes the community to action, right? That brings you together at a moment of crisis. America the Beautiful does not, right? So I don't think America Beautiful will ever really work as an anthem, because although it's a prettier song in some ways, and it's a more lovely lyric, when you need an anthem, the Star Spangled Banner works for us in a way that America the Beautiful doesn't really work. At least that's what I think musically is the reason why it's there. It may be that some people write a new verse or that we write a new song, but it's going to be something that happens organically. It's not going to happen because Congress says, oh, we're changing the national anthem. It's going to be Take Me Out to the Ball Game. Just decided, right? It's the national anthem. Start playing it. And it wouldn't work, right? People wouldn't feel that way. So, yeah.
Could you suggest a nonprofit
institution or organization to which I might most appropriately donate a collection of several dozen pieces of political sheet music in many.
There's a local institution called the University of Michigan, which I highly recommend. we'll talk. I think Elaine wants to stop, but do we have one more? Quickly. Right.
In more plays, Ann Arbor Symphony, there's one. Okay. But sports events, it could be a wrestling match, it could be a swimming meet.
Like the Dexter Ann Arbor 5K, we usually play the Star Spangled Banner.
Yeah. It doesn't have to do with sports. You know, in our culture today, is it because it's a fighting song?
No, at least I don't think so. I mean, there is an aspect of it that's, you know, that, you know, things, especially when Ohio State's in town, there's a war going on, right? So that's sort of appropriate in that manner. And I do think it is a kind of ritual moment of unity. It has certain functions within a game, just like to tell everybody, hey, we're about to play ball, so everybody come back from the you know, concession stands, we're about to start. But really it's tied to World War II is the ultimate answer to that. But what's interesting, particularly about the way you phrased your question, is that sports ends up becoming sort of the late comer to the party in that the place we started singing at first was actually in the movie theaters, right? So what happened when it became the national anthem in 1931 is everyone said, what? What's that tune? Like, nobody knew the words, really. People knew the words sort of around World War I because it was sung a lot, but in the 1920s it wasn't. We were having the Roaring Twenties, right? Everybody was listening to jazz. They weren't worried about world conflict. Everything was about isolationism, so we weren't really dealing with all of this kind of war strife. And so the Star Spangled Banner actually sort of goes back underground in the 1920s. And so in the 1930s, as war clouds are gathering in Europe, the Star Spangled Banner actually lays the groundwork for World War II. You would think that Pearl Harbor happened and then everybody started singing the Star Spangled Banner. In fact, the Star Spangled Banner starts to rise in popularity about 5 years before, 35, 36. And one of the ways is with newsreels. Right, so if you remember the old movies, people used to go to the movies all the time for a bunch of reasons. It's no TV, right? The only place in town that's air-conditioned is where? The movie theater, right? So and there's like four or five new movies a week, right? So you go out and you're going to go see all these movies. So one of the things is you got your news from the movies in between, right? So one of the other things they had these little shorts, these newsreels. One of them was actually like of the U.S. Navy choir singing the Star Spangled Banner with the bouncing ball and the words going on. And that was intentionally to teach everybody in America what the words were. Right? So we learned it actually in the movie theaters first. And then it's about halfway through 1941. So April, May, June 1931 41 is when we start having it at every single game in professional sports. It's being done pretty frequently. So for baseball, for example, every opening day would always have the Star Spangled Banner. Interestingly, July 4th was not an occasion to play the Star Spangled Banner at the ballpark. But early on, if you wanted to have the Star Spangled Banner at a sporting event, you had to hire a live band, because we hadn't invented recording we got, but we hadn't had public address systems until the late 1920s, early 30s. So that's the first time where we could start doing it. But still, you'd only did it for the opening day and for the World Series were the only times you would have the Star Spangled Banner until 1941, but it's before Pearl Harbor, which is sort of the interesting thing. You would think it'd be after, but it's actually in anticipation. So when Pearl Harbor happens, the whole country's actually been revving up for this for a while, but that's the tipping point. Thank you for those great questions. I just wanted to end with two songs. And you should stand for both of these. The first is Lift Every Voice and Sing, which was a song actually written for Lincoln's birthday in 1900 for a school in Florida. And you'll learn that if you don't know the tune, you'll learn it pretty quickly. It's sometimes called the African-American anthem. And then we'll end with the service version, the 1917 arrangement of the Star Spangled Banner.
Lift every voice and sing.
Thank you very much.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, in the continuing tradition of excitement, variety, and education at the Ford Presidential Library, aren't you glad you came? Mark and our musicians, Jennifer and Paola, thank you so much. This was wonderful. I think it's great. I'm going to be recommending it to our team at the museum. This is far too good to just keep in Ann Arbor. We've got to get it on the other side of the state. Mark, since you remember President Ford and the bicentennial, I think that our gift for you maybe is very appropriate, which is a set of pens with the signature of none other than Gerald R. Ford. So may you use those in good health and lots more writing and research. This was wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so much.